God, anybody around here want to have church tonight? That's what I want to know. That's right. Or you want to just sit around and we could play tiddlywinks or something, I guess. You know, you'd have to show me. I forgot I hadn't played them in years. I used to know how to play dominoes, but I wouldn't know how to do that anymore either. I used to know how to play solitaire. Well, thank you, Jesus. And you know you got to come up here and help me and bring your tambourine. Remember, bring your tambourine, man. Why not? There's an art to playing a tambourine in the correct manner. Yes, get your pretty little red microphone and turn it on. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We got a few people coming in. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, Father, we thank you, Lord, that we're in America and we can get together and do this. There's people in foreign countries, communist countries in China and stuff. They can't get together like this and worship Jesus. They have to hide somewhere out in the woods or in somebody's house. And they live in fear of getting busted and thrown in prison for worshiping Jesus. We thank you that we can do it. At least we can do it right now without getting arrested. Lord, we pray for our country. We need a mighty revival in our country, Lord. We pray that your power would go to work on our country, Lord, in Jesus' name. And we ask that you touch everybody that's here tonight, Lord. Let the word go into them and build their faith and help them. Holy Spirit, we want you to flow here tonight. We believe in all the gifts of the Spirit, Holy Spirit. There's 9 of them, and we like them. We want them. We crave the manifestation of the power of God, the anointing that breaks the yoke. We crave it. We want it. We need it. We're a needy people, Jesus. We can't get by without you, Lord. We got to have you, Lord. We want you, more of you. We're here, Lord. We might not be very many of us, but our heart is right. We love you, and we're hungry, Lord, and want you to come down tonight and be with us in a special way. We know you're here because you told us where 2 or 3 are gathered in your name that you're here. So we give you free reign. Walk up and down these aisles and go all around here, Jesus, and do what you want to do, Master. It's all right. We love you, and we give you all the praise and honor. Satan, you're bound right now. You're bound. Your power's cut off. In Jesus' name, there'll be no hindrance or interference in this service whatsoever. In Jesus' mighty name.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you, Lord. It's good to see everybody we know and love out there. How you doing, my friend? It's good to see everybody. Big Daddy Gerald right there. Amen. My friend from Van Alstine back there. And the dynamic duo from Van Alstine right there. And Sister Velmer with her new hairdo. And little Jimmy that's not little anymore. Now we'll have to change it to Massive Jimmy. Yeah. Right? And my brother here that drives the UPS truck all over everywhere. There he is right there, Brother Spencer and his wife. Amen. We got the Durant brother right here. Amen. And my brother back here with the Harley Davidson hat. Amen. American made Harley Davidson.
Amen.
It used to be everything made in America was good, but now, I don't know, man. Most everything's made overseas now, it seems like. But you know what? They can't take away this salvation we got. It came from heaven. Amen. We don't have to worry about it. It wasn't made overseas or it wasn't made at all. It's straight from God the Father to us.
Yes.
In Jesus' name, man. And you know what? Whatever happens, they making, you know, we hope it don't happen, but Man, if something happens and they could take you and they could lock you in the slammer or they could take everything you had away from you, but what I got from Jesus, they ain't nothing can take it away from us. That's one thing we got. Ain't nobody can steal it from us.
Right, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
I sure am glad too. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. And we give you all the praise and glory. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Amen. We got Brother George here, the ex-hippie down here on the front row. There he is. Amen. And we got Brother Gary, the radiator man back there. There he is right there. If you need your radiator fixed, that brother, he'll put in a Holy Ghost anointing on your radiator, man. Amen. When you drive your car, you'll want to sing Power in the Blood or something, you know. Yeah. Amen. And we believe in having fun. If the Holy Spirit tells you to do something, to shout or dance or whatever, man, help yourself. We're around here to, we want to encourage everybody to obey the Lord. That's what it's all about. Oh, thank you, Lord. You could come up here and help me since my voice is hoarse. Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. And then I won't have to sing as hard, and my voice will be better later on, see? Yeah, come stand right up here. Amen. It's nice to have ladies with nice voices to help you. Here, I got it turned on here. I'll kind of help you get it started, and then I'll let you all do it. I usually just... The Holy Ghost shows me, and I just jump around and sing different songs on the list. It's not too, you know. I like that one you sang. I feel through coming on. Yeah.
I feel my breakthrough coming on. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough coming on. I feel my breakthrough coming on. Well, now I feel my breakthrough coming on. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough coming on. I feel my healing.
I feel my healing
coming on. Thank you, Jesus.
I feel my healing
coming on. I feel my healing.
I feel my healing. I feel my healing
coming on. Hallelujah, I feel the Spirit coming in. Yeah, now I feel the Spirit coming in. I feel the Spirit. I feel the Spirit. I feel the Spirit coming in. I feel my breakthrough.
I feel my breakthrough
coming on. Right now I feel my breakthrough coming on. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough. I feel my breakthrough coming on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, I feel better, so much better. Since I lay my burdens down, I feel better, so much better, since I lay my burdens down. Burdens down, Lord, burdens down, Lord,
anointed, be with Jesus. Since I laid my burdens down, I'm going home to live with Jesus. Since I laid my burdens down. Hallelujah, since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burdens down. I can live so God can use me, since I laid my burdens down. I can live so God can use me, since I laid my burdens down. Oh, glory, glory, hallelujah, since I laid my burdens down. Glory, glory, hallelujah, Jesus on the main line, okay. Tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. Oh, if you want your sins forgiven,
tell him what you want.
Oh, if you want your sins forgiven, tell him what you want. Oh, if you want your sins forgiven, tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line, tell him what you want. Oh, call him up and tell him what you want. You ought to call him up, call him up, tell him what you want. You ought to call him up, call him up, tell him what you want. You ought to call him up, call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up and tell him what you want.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to know who can stand before you when we call on that great name, Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, we have the victory in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we have the victory. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, Satan, he'll have to flee. Who can stand before us when we call on that great name? Jesus, we have the victory. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine.
I told
your sail. Get thee behind. Victory today is mine. Joy is mine. Joy is mine. Joy today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Joy today is mine. Victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, get thee behind. Victory today is mine.
When I rose this morning, I didn't have no doubt. I knew that the Lord would bring me out. Oh, I fell down on my knees, crying, Lord, help me, please. Got up singing and shouting the victory. Oh, victory is mine. Victory is mine. Victory today is mine. I told Satan, you get thee behind. Victory today. Yes, Lord.
There is power, power,
wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
All right. Okay. We just got to sit down. I am redeemed. I'm bought with a price. Jesus, he saved my whole life. If was hate, love now abides. Where there was confusion, love now reigns. Now I'm walking with Jesus, and it's all because, it's all because I'm redeemed. I am redeemed. I'm bought with a price. Jesus, he saved my am. I want you to tell them I am. I'm redeemed.
Okay, Jeff.
I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm a soldier in the army. I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. I'm a soldier
in the army.
I've got my war clothes on
in the army of the Lord.
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army,
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army of the Lord,
I've got my war clothes on.
In the army,
I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord,
I'm a soldier.
In the army,
I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord,
I'm a soldier.
In the army,
if I die, let me die.
In the army of the Lord,
if I die, let me die.
In the army,
if I die, let me die.
In the army of the Lord,
if I die, let me die.
In the army,
I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord,
I'm a soldier.
In the army,
I'm a soldier.
In the army of the Lord,
I'm a soldier.
In the army.
Okay, you get up, Jeff.
Yeah, sing the Bless That Wonderful Name of Jesus.
Bless that wonderful name, name of Jesus. Oh, bless that wonderful name
of Jesus.
Oh, bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, there's no other name
I know.
Oh, bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, no other name
I know.
Oh, there's power in the name,
in the name of Jesus.
There is power in that name,
in the name of Jesus.
There is power in that name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, there is no other name
I know.
Oh, there's victory in that name,
in the name of Jesus.
Oh, there's victory in the name,
in the name of Jesus.
Oh, there's victory in the name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, no other name
I know.
Come on and bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Come on and bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Come on and bless that wonderful name,
name of Jesus.
Oh, no other name I know.
Yeah, and it's hallelujah anyhow.
Never, never let your troubles get you down. When life's problems come your way, hold your head up high and say, hallelujah anyhow. Hold your head up high and say, hallelujah anyhow. Oh, amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. I'm singing one for now.
Get you down.
When life's problems come your way, hold your head up high and say, hallelujah anyhow. must Jesus bear the cross alone and all the world go free? I tell you, there's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. I'm singing hallelujah anyhow. Never, never let your troubles get you down. When life problems come your way, hold your head up high and say hallelujah anyhow.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Boy, isn't that good?
Praise the Lord.
Man, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. Well, thank you, ladies. Y'all did a great job, man. Be sure you turn your mic off so it doesn't squeal. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Shakalala bahane. Amen.
Amen.
And now Brother Spencer is going to come up here and tell us how much he loves Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. This guy's a, this is a prison preacher. He goes into prisons. You talk about a captive audience, but you know what? I'd rather preach to them than a lot of other folks I know, brother.
Amen.
They're hungry and they want help, you know.
Yeah, they are hungry. Bible says those that hunger and thirst after righteousness shall be filled.
Amen.
Hallelujah. God is good. No, God wants to use us all for his glory. For his glory. I was talking to a guy last night. He'd been drinking. And he was trying to apologize for some things that were going on across from my mother's house. And I was just listening to him. You know, you can't really talk sense to a drunk. But he made a mistake of start talking about the Bible.
Yeah.
And he started trying to tell me who God was and what God expected. And I was listening to him. I said, brother, what's the point? I never understood the point. But we got into a little, not a argument, but we was talking about, you know, it's preached a lot. A lot of people preach come as you are as something quoted in the Bible, but it's not written there verbatim, come as you are. And I said, well, brother, show me what it is. It's in the Bible, it's in the Bible, it's in Matthew. I said, I'm going to come by tomorrow, you show me what it is. Because
yeah.
Once you start talking about the Word of God, you stir me up.
Yeah.
I get stirred up. Uh-huh. And see, I'm going to follow up. So I went by today just to talk to him, and he was staying with some other folks. And I asked him, Where was it at in the Bible? He said, I hadn't had a chance to look. He didn't have a Bible. But to make a long story short, we started talking about God.
Amen.
And we had church right in the driveway.
Amen.
Talking
Amen.
About God and the glory of God and how what God expected of them. And
yeah.
And I told him, God's got a plan and a purpose for you and for me. I said, and the wife said, well, I've been going to church all my life. And I said, but have you ever had a relationship with God? Mm-hmm. You can go to church, but it's all about a relationship.
Yes,
and knowing God and spending time with God, meditating and praying with God.
Yes.
That's where God has gotten me.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a great place because I don't ever want to go back to what I was because it doesn't exist. I'm a new creation. We're a new creation in Christ.
Yeah.
All is new and the old is passed away.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. I'm going to tell you a testimony how God works. I believe God controls every facet of my life.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been working for UPS for about 20 years, and I got fired for some mistake I made.
Uh-huh.
Got fired, got walked off the job, and they said the only way you can get your job back is you got to go to Florida. A jury there will hear your case and decide. Well, I told my father-in-law, I don't know, I'm afraid about it. He said, don't pray about it. I got the money, you go. If you get the job, pay me back. If you don't worry about it.
Uh-huh.
God's got a plan for us.
Yeah.
I went to Florida thinking I was getting my job back, but I went to Florida, I started praying with people that had lost their job. And we get outside the motel, hotel, and we be on the parking lot praying, God is able. If a door closes, God opens another door. Yeah. He'll close one door, but God's going to make a way for us. Amen. And before the trip was over, they were preaching to me what God was going to do. I said, oh, God, is that why I'm here? But the whole time I met a friend, a guy named Alex Roman Guerra. I'll never forget his name, Alex Roman Guerra. He bought me all my meals, prayed with me, took care of me. And I looked, I said, God, you sent me down here not just to get my job back, but to encourage other people that had lost their job.
Yeah.
And God gave me my job back.
Amen.
He restored.
Amen.
God is awesome, man.
Yes, he is.
God is awesome. You can't tell me he ain't real because I know he is.
Yes, he is. Yes, he is.
Amen. And I'm going to witness. I'm going to testify. I'm going to pray with folks. I'm going to believe God because God is moving behind his word.
Yeah.
And we got to preach the word.
Yeah.
We got to live a life. One thing I know, you got to live something. You can talk about God, but how you living. Because they're watching us. They're watching us. The devil's watching. Everybody else is watching.
Yeah.
When you walk the straight and narrow with God, the glory of God's going to get behind you, and it's going to be with you in every situation.
Yeah.
And I always say this. Sometimes it's not the devil. Sometimes God will put you in a situation.
Uh-huh.
I lost my job, but I got it back. But it was for his glory that I even lost it and got it back. People were wondering, how did he get his job back?
Uh-huh.
I thought he was fired. They were telling people on my ride, he's gone.
Uh-huh.
God got the final say, man.
Yeah.
And God's got the glory that we need.
Amen.
God's got the truth. He's got the word. Yeah. He's got the lifestyle. All we got to do is follow God and nobody else.
Amen.
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 It's a song I'm going to sing. I'm not a great singer, but I think this song tells how I feel. It's about being anointed, and each one of us is anointed by God. We didn't, some of us don't know it, but we got the anointing in us.
Amen.
I'm anointed to anoint, to fall at Jesus' feet, to break open the box, to anoint him with my tears. Out of my brokenness, out of my failures, I found my true calling. I'm anointed to anoint, and you are too. I'm anointed to anoint, to fall at Jesus' feet, to break open the box, to anoint him with my tears. Out of my brokenness, out of my failures, I found my true calling. I'm anointed to anoint. Yes, I found my true calling. I'm anointed to anoint. And you are too. God bless you. Give God a hand praise. Amen. If you love Jesus, give him a shout. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Oh.
Whoa, whoa.
Yes, hallelujah. Ooh. Man, y'all ever see that scripture in there? It says you overcome by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony.
Yeah.
When you give a testimony, it's just a little one, you get blessed. Right, you do, you get blessed.
Yeah.
So that's the reason Brother Don's going to come up here and tell us how much he loves Jesus. And I think he wins the long driving award all the way from Durant, Oklahoma. I love this brother, man. He's a good guy.
Hallelujah. I love the Lord with all my heart. I worship God and I appreciate you all coming in and worship God with me.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
All right. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And if you're curious about the pre-Adamite world, you might want to ask that brother. He'll show you some stuff about it. It looks like there was something here before Adam got here. Ooh. That's kind of deep, isn't it? Amen, amen. Hallelujah. And over here, we've got Big Daddy Gerald Hughes. And he's going to come up and say how much he loves Jesus tonight. Right? and whatever else the Lord gives him, ain't no telling what he might say. I know he'll obey the Holy Ghost.
How y'all doing tonight? I just want to bless the Lord. I got my church family here tonight from Van Austin, and they never heard my testimony. So they're going to get to hear it tonight. Back about, was it June 15th or April? Like one of them, it's 15, I don't remember, it's been about 3 months ago. I was working and I passed out. Don't know what happened. But I woke up, I had a trait in my throat, couldn't talk. But I was curious what this thing was in my throat, so I started pulling and turning it loose. And I pulled a trait loose and pulled it out. And I was bleeding to death on the table, and they had to take me to surgery. I coded it, so that means straight line. So I didn't know nothing about it. The next day, I woke up and I told my mother the dream that I had. I told her that I was sitting there and I died on the table and I had an out-of-body experience. Now, as I was going up that tunnel, I seen a bright light. This light was brighter than any light I ever seen in my life. I was just trying to get there. As I got so close to it, I just stopped, like on the elevator, just stopped. And couldn't figure out why. And so I felt a warm hand like sun touch me on my shoulder. And it was the Lord said, you have to return. And I like, why bring me this far to turn me around? So, like, I went in reverse and I went back down. As I got close enough, I saw myself laying on that table. And I said, wow, that's me. So when I entered my body, then they hit me with those paddles and thought my ribs exploded. And that was the Lord put me right back in, and I heard that thing go deep, deep. So I said, Lord, have mercy, I'm back. I'm telling my mother there, and she said, son, I'm going to tell you, that what happened. She said, you died, and they brought you back. And I said, no, they didn't bring me back. The Lord brought me back. Because I went to heaven. I was on my way to heaven. I mean, I was ready to go there, but I'm glad he brought me back. Because I enjoyed going to church. Since Pastor Radcliffe, Brother Bourne, I don't know how they hooked up, but they passed by my house. And Pastor Bourne asked me, did I want to go to church? And I said, sure. I said, sure. I was in prison for 3.5 years. I went to church every day. I said, well, I'm going to get to go to church again. So Pastor Radcliffe, he helped me do some work on my eye. And he said, you have to come to church for 18 times. I said, 18 times? I mean, I said, wow, hey, that's a lot of time to go. So about 2 years later, I'm still going to church with them. And I love each and every one of them, and I just thank God for saving me. But 1998, I got saved up in this very tent. And my brother Jeff, he was picking on me, and I was picking on him. But that night, I didn't know he was going to pull my cord. So he pulled me. I sat out outside. I get me a chair and sit out there at the back edge of the fence. And that fence back there, that whatever this thing's called. And he was telling me that, as a brother, I know he want to be saved. And I'm sitting there, I said, well, he sounds like he's talking to me. But I wasn't sure. I had my sister and her husband there with him. And he got there looking at me and said, yeah, brother, I'm talking to you. And he said, if you ain't a coward, come up here and accept the Lord for your Savior. So I couldn't let him call me out like that. So I got up and I walked up here. I didn't know what to expect. Said the sinner's prayer and got saved right there. And so I backslid one time, but I ain't backsliding no more. God done saved me twice. And third time, he might not let me just come on in. So I'm going to obey what he tell me to do.
Amen.
Yeah. And the other day, I have to say this because one of my dear friends went on to be with the Lord. She had liver cancer. Liver cancer. It was messed up. Brother Jeff, Brother Boy, and I, we went over and prayed for her. And when she went to report to the doctor the next time, he said, what is wrong with her liver? So he sent her home and let her go. And 2 months later, she stayed at home and the devil hit her again. And this time he took her out. But you know what? She opened her eyes and looked at me and gave me the prettiest smile. And I knew then that she's going to heaven. So right now, she's in heaven looking down on me. I'm just mad about one thing. She beat me there. But I'm thankful for that.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah, she told Gerald, she says, I don't think I'm saved. And Gerald says, oh, no, we can fix that. And so he got me and Brother Bowen, and we went over there. We had church in her room. We preached to her a while, and Brother Bowen sung her a song, and we gave her the whole works, and she got saved, man. Remember that? She had tears in her eyes. Boy, the Holy Ghost worked her over. And if you hadn't obeyed the Lord, brother, she wouldn't have gone to heaven, man. Man, that's a great feeling. You know, wouldn't it be nice when you get to heaven to have a great multitude of people there greet you when you get there and say, man, I appreciate you. You're the one that shared the Lord with me, and I wouldn't have made it without you. Man, that's going to make you feel good.
Yeah.
Man, that's going to make you feel good. And then, see, we got a motley crew here, but how many know Jesus uses a motley crew, right? Did you ever see the people he hung around, man? They were tax collectors and fishermen and people that the goody-goody people looked down on them, man. But Jesus saw their heart. Praise God that the Lord looks at the heart. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
He looks at the heart. He don't look at your pedigree. He don't look at your education. He don't look at your background or your race or anything else. He looks at your heart. Uh-huh. And man, I sure am glad. You know what?
Amen.
Man, this brother here, man, you got such a great smile, brother. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And then in the back here, we have that famous man known throughout the country as Gary the Radiator Man right back there. Amen. He's going to come up and tell you he loves Jesus too. Come on, Gary. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. This is a good brother. He encourages me a lot, man, and he gives them dual service. They get their radiator fixed, and he tells them about Jesus. Amen.
Well, I grew up in a Baptist church, and I would get saved and backslide every week, you know, like they do in the Baptist church. You get right with the Lord on Sunday morning, and you go back into sin because you don't know anything except salvation. That's all I knew. And I got tired of living like that. It just seemed like a struggle, and no matter how bad I wanted to, I couldn't seem to overcome. It's like trying to drive a car without gas. It just ain't going to happen.
Amen.
And I wound up leaving the church for years, and I grew up in a salvage yard, a junkyard, and I had a junkyard dog, and I was so crazy that the dog thought I was crazy, and the dog was crazier. You know, junkyard dogs, they're mean, they're crazy. I mean, you feed them gunpowder and rats and copperhead snakes, and to keep them mean, to keep the people out of the salvage yard at night. But I wound up going to a little charismatic church, and they introduced me to the message of being filled with the Holy Ghost, and I was so hungry, I didn't know what it was, and I was scared and hungry. I wanted to run to the front and run out the back door at the same time, and I wound up getting filled with the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues.
Amen,
and I remember thinking, because I've always really despised hypocrites, and I remember thinking, you know, if this is real, I'm not going to, you know, do, if God fills me, he'll just have to fill me. I mean, I'm not going to try to speak in tongues. And this beautiful language just come gushing out of me, just gushing. I was trying to talk in English and saying, thank you, Jesus. And it was just going, shigiri-bibi-stakami-shagaloma hakiya-daibi. And it was just coming out like that, just flowing naturally.
Amen.
And I got filled with the Holy Ghost. And the first thing I noticed, nobody really told me this would happen, but the first thing I noticed is I had a supernatural power to resist sin, the desires of the flesh, you know, the lust of the flesh and the pride of life and the things that always would drag a young man down. didn't appeal to me anymore. They just lost their glitter. And I just was hungry for Jesus and the Word of God and going to church. And so all I could think about was praying and studying. And I just grew like a weed for years. And we were real poor. I married my wife. Her daddy died on her 7th birthday. And she was so broken when I met her. She had been molested and abused. And her mother left us when she was 7 years old, and she's just left to raise herself, and her older siblings would eat all the food stamp food up in the first week, and her twin brother would eat lettuce and cake mix or anything they could find to survive, just as little 8, 7, 8, 9, 10-year-old kids. And then she wound up marrying a meth addict and had a little girl with Down syndrome and a little boy, and then, of course, she really didn't have a marriage. And by the time I come along, I remember she was probably in her early 20s, and she was living in a motel, where you pay a daily rate to live in a cheap motel. And I met her, and we wound up getting married, and we were so far down in life, we had to look up to see bottom. and so we started going to church and trying to get our lives turned around and stuff. And I had to borrow a car. My dad had a salvage yard, so he had this old car that had been T-boned in the passenger side. It was an old Ford Granada, and the passenger doors were smashed into about right here when you were in the driver's seat. And I'd pull up at the convenience store, and people would run up and ask me if I needed an ambulance and if I was hurt and if anybody else was hurt, like I'd just been in a wreck, you know. And I remember I'd buy like a dollar's worth of gas and put it in there. And back then, gas was like $1.50 a gallon, but I'd drive to work, and I'd kill the car and coast down the hill and start it up, go up the next hill, and just a couple of miles to work. Well, on the way back one night, one cold November night, and it was rainy and drizzly, and I got off, and this old salvage yard is failing, and I'm so broke, and we're just barely hanging on, just barely have a roof over our head, And I told my wife, we're not going to tell anybody we need anything. And if God does not provide for us, and if this word's not true and these promises, because when you have nothing to grab a hold of, but the word, it's everything. It's your lifeboat, your anchor. If it don't come through, you're done. And we had little kids, and people would give us deer meat and potatoes and beans. And remember walking a couple of miles in that rain and walked to the house, and there was some beans and potatoes on the stove, and you know how they kind of skim over after they've been cold a couple of hours. And my wife asked me if I wanted anything to eat, and I was so deflated, and I said no, and I just hit the bottom. I just said, God, if this is real, if you're real, if your promises and your word are real, I have to know. I'm banking everything I have on you. I need help. And I wound up going to this Assembly of God church, and this man gave his testimony, James Keaton. And he had been an old hippie in Arkansas, and he hitchhiked to Denison, Texas. And he got saved and filled with the Holy Ghost, and he wound up being the associate pastor of this church, but I didn't know it. And he was he cut hair for a living. He had this long red hair, and he had a successful barber shop called Imperial Barbers. It's still there in Denison today on West Morton Street in Denison. And I would go in there to get a haircut, and all these pretty women are in there, and it just made me so nervous just going in there, you know, because coming out of an old salvage yard, I was just... But he gave his testimony one night and talked about how he had to hitchhike in town, and how he was so poor and came from, his father had left him and came from a family where his mother was very sick and died and early, and he just kind of said he would live in the woods of Arkansas and kill cranes and crows and rabbits and squirrels and fish and just live out there and eat and just try to survive. And you know, I remember he came from so far down and uneducated and all to where he is now. I could see the hand of God in his life. I could see the hand of God was working in his life, and that and after he, because I thought this man was born with a silver spoon in his mouth, and all these church people don't know where I come from. They're not in touch with reality. They would all, you know, come from well-to-do, up the, grew up in church, and I'm the outsider here, and nobody knows or understands where I've come from. Then he gave his testimony, and that night it really changed my life. It was a turning point, and I said, Lord, if you can do that for him, there's hope for me.
Yeah.
Because and it gave me something to hang on to, because I thought everybody else had been born way ahead of me, had some kind of advantage, and that I was the only one. Me and the people I hung around were the only ones that were just almost doomed to failure. And I wound up staying in that church for 14 years, and I was elected onto the board of the church, and then I became the secretary of the board, and I became an elder and a head usher. And they started asking me to speak in that church, and I would speak on a regular basis there. And it wasn't long, and there was a great visitation from God at that time, so the church grew. I'll wrap this up in just maybe 5 more minutes. This church, because... Well, if I drop it now, I'll just leave everybody hanging. And this visitation, a revival, came into the church, and people would get slain in the spirit and healed, and they'd get what they called drunk in the spirit. And I didn't know what that was, you know, till it happened to me. And your legs feel like rubber, and you can't walk and stuff, but as a result of that, the church grew from about 150 to 500 people in this little church. Then we started planning to build, and we wound up building a church that would hold 1,000, and that church is there now. But during that time, I began to see the goodness and the power of God working in my life, and how God, I was telling some brothers earlier today, as the secretary of the board, I had to sign a loan document for $1.9 million for a loan to build the new church, and I didn't have enough credit to buy a car. They put me on a board, a trustee board. It was a trust fund of $100,000, and these handpicked 5 board members are supposed to decide how to make that money generate profit. And the Lord told me, he said, gold's going to go up. I didn't know anything about gold, except you could make rings out of it, but he said gold is going to go up. And so we have this board meeting. This millionaire on the board said, well, we're not making any interest at the bank. He said, Brother Gary, what do you think? You have any ideas about what we should do? I said, well, the Lord told me gold was going to go up. At the time, it was like $850. 5 years later, it went up to and peaked at $1,800. And they didn't invest in it. If they had, they would have over doubled their money. But I saw God start working in my life and elevating me and exalting me into positions that I didn't qualify for at all, and began to use me. And then I wound up leaving that church under good terms and everything, went to a smaller church, and I'm doing a ministry there now. But I just want to encourage everybody here, it doesn't matter where you came from, how much you know or don't know the goodness and the glory and the anointing and power of God is on your life if you're born again. And the potential in you is limitless to what God can do in your life, in your realm of influence. And just don't ever let the devil or anybody else tell you that you don't qualify for the greatness of God to use you in mighty ways in your life. And I think he's going to do it in these last days. Thank you.
Thank you, Jesus. I tell you what, you can't rule Jesus out now. He can take you from nothing and nowhere and elevate you. And you wouldn't know that brother came from that background. He's a successful businessman. Amen. You know, he lives in a brick home and drives a nice car, and you wouldn't know that he come from nothing. Mm-hmm. He was a full-blown alcoholic at one time. Man, if he can do that for that guy, he can do it for any of us. Amen? Yes. Amen. And the Holy Spirit's kind of doing something different tonight. Everybody's getting a chance to say a few words for Jesus. And on the front row right here, we've got George the ex-hippie right here on the front row from California. And George is going to say just a few words here and tell us where he's coming from. He's a pretty good old guy, and we love him.
Thank you, brother. Boy, you don't know where to start, do you? But God's rich love. That's one thing. See, my mother took me to Salvation Army and traded me in because I was messed up, and she wanted another one. They said, get rid of this. But I found out I didn't know what to do. I didn't understand. I thought Jesus come once a year like Santa Claus. I didn't have a clue. Yes, I thought he just once a year, you know, and he's a little baby. I don't know he ever grown up, you know. I said, Lord Jesus. God got a hold of me. How many times, I can't tell you. And sometimes we wonder if he really cares about everything in us and on us. And I'm telling you, because you came tonight, you don't know what to expect. But you're looking for Jesus. And you want a word from the King of Glory. You don't want to hear just talk. But you want the one that made you like you are. And kind of understand what he wants in you. Do you know he wants to create his son in you? Separate from you. But using your personality. He said, Paul said, how I travail in birth till the Holy Spirit do in you and make Christ a reality 7 days, 24/7. Now, I didn't believe anything. You could tell. I said, yeah, BS. I know I'd say that. You could tell me anything about the Bible. I'd read it. I'd try to believe it. I think so many of us believe in unbelief. We believe certain things. But God is going to do something in this last hour. I worked in Mexico among orphans. I worked in Mexico in churches. Started a church with him and did a lot of work for Jesus, but it wasn't my work, it was his. And I don't know what I'm doing right now, except I want to be used again, don't you? Aren't you tired of doing nothing? Doesn't it make you sick go to church and listen to somebody else talk and give me your money now. I said, what's this? I want Jesus. I don't want no pep talk. I don't want no lie in the name of Jesus. I don't want sometime Jesus. I want everything he is to be real to me. And Jesus said, I know you. You came here tonight for a word from God. Now the Holy Spirit, I'm asking him know in this hour, it seemed like darkness has more power. But I tell you, I am in you a light, and they're going to become more attracted to me in you than ever before. I'm going to make your body and your mouth mine. I'm going to do in you what I wanted to done for a long time. I'm going to make you a living, walking testament of my goodness and my mercy and my glory. Because you love me. Do you really? Are you willing to give everything you are so he can be everything he is in you? Will you let him create his son? Will you let him develop his life in your life? Will you let him be what he is in all of his wonderful glory? He said, my truth will prove to you my faithfulness, and you'll be able to feed on my faithfulness. Because I love you, and what I tell you, you know it's me, will come to pass for thee. I started out, I was in a wreck in 1965, drugged up, drunk. The man driving, we flipped the car over, killed him. I woke up 2 weeks later. Messed up. He wouldn't put me on candy camera. Lord, I know it. These trials are past. Wow. Stay up. Now. Yeah, I ain't wanting to go over here. I'm not a TV addict. I'm a Jesus addict. But Billy Graham, I didn't know nothing about Billy Graham. But I turned that thing on, and what he said, I thought it was a con job again. You know, I thought, yeah, all them guys were just con artists getting money. I said, shoot, they got a good job. They just tell people anything they want to. Send you money. I'll send you a piece of cloth you can put on your head, put on your foot. I said, Lord, please. Is nobody love you? Is nobody real? Will they not live and walk the truth? Will nobody care about you? Will nobody love the ones that nobody else wants? Is there still so much hate and prejudice wherever we go that we can't be ourselves and be accepted just like we are? Is that still predominant? God, break the walls. God, tear them down. In Jesus' name. But I got saved through Billy Graham. I knew something happened, but I didn't know what. But ever since he got a hold on me, I've not been the same You know, I didn't believe even when I was a believer. I think so many believe in unbelief. Come on, be real. You believe certain things, don't you? But there's some of it you kind of, I'm not sure about that. Come on. You don't want to admit what you really are. And the only thing good in us is Him. And I thank God. I said, Father, He said, you own the cattle on 1,000 hills. What does that mean to a poor boy like me? It don't mean nothing. And I got angry and said it, and I cut my Father in heaven's heart. You know that wall where I was staying went away, the place went away, and a great white wall came in front of me from heaven. Don't know how wide, how long, how high. But up at the top come a pair of eyes, the Father. And He looked down on me and said, who do you think you are? I was wanting to do a disappearing act. But He looked me up and down, inside out. And He said, this I did not know. And He walked this way, and the Son, Jesus, came to Him and said, Father, this and this and this. And He interceded for me. Now, I'm telling you, each one of you here are very important. Do what He's asked you to do. Say what He's asked you to say. Let Him live His life completely. You know, God, my God, had mercy on me one more time. But be careful with how you look at Him and how you talk about Him. Amen. When you're in trouble and down. Because sometimes you can cut the Father's heart like I did, and you don't want to seem that way. Because it's a reality. It's not a joke, God. It's not a... Father, I thank you for letting me be here tonight. He said, if you don't believe me and you don't trust me, how can I bless you? Are you full of faith, or do you really trust me? And do you really love me? And do you want me more than anything else? I gotta be number one in your life. For you are my wife and I'm married to you. I've paid the complete price. And I'm coming soon and my reward is with me. I'm going to give you for what you've done, whether it's good or bad. Okay? God bless you, love you, thank you.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Man, he's got a unique style, don't he? Amen. It kind of reminds me, I knew an old brother, Larry Moore. I had a friend named Larry Moore, and he flowed in a style kind of like yours, brother. Amen. Everybody flows in their own style, you know. You got to be yourself with Jesus. Everybody's style is cool. And Brother Bowen, you got a cool style. Come down here and say a few words. Amen. Doesn't he do a good job playing the organ for us? This brother, he's helped me for years now. And this guy's a Holy Ghost preacher. He's got a church in Medill, Oklahoma. Amen.
Amen. I give honor to God tonight and to all the officials of God, and thank Him, praise God. David said, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise. Somebody say, His praise. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Let's give God a hand, praise. God is so good, and he's worthy to be praised. I was thinking a few minutes ago when the disciples was out on the boat and the waves began to toss and turn. A storm came up. And they asked Jesus to help them. And he calmed the raging sea. He spoke, and it was so. There was a time when Jesus was walking on the water, and the disciples saw him, and they thought it was a ghost. And Peter said, "Lord, if it be thou walking on the water, bid me to come and walk on the water." And Jesus said, "Come." Peter got out of the boat, and I believe it's Brother Jeff was talking about it last night. Peter got out of the boat and began to walk on the water to meet Jesus. And he took his eyes off Jesus and he began to sink. And he said, "Lord, save me." And I was thinking a few years ago, I was going to work, it snowed and ice was on the road. Praise the Lord. And I was going to get on to the highway. And I saw a gap where I could get on the highway. And I speeded up. Forgot that the road was slick. And I got to the bridge and my vehicle began to toss and turn. And I was trying to keep it on the road. And I was doing to my steering wheel this way and that way. And I was just sliding all over the road. And I could just imagine me having a wreck, messing up my vehicle. And I said, "Lord, help me." And just in a second, he stopped my car from sliding all over that road. It just stopped still, just like that. And you know, I thank God because he heard my prayer. And he delivered me, and he set me free. Praise, I didn't have an accident. Praise the Lord, and I just continued on the work in the hands of Jesus. And I thank God because he knows what's going to happen. He knows when we're going to call on him. And the Bible said he's a very help in trouble. And I thank him, praise God, I had many times when God helped me. One night I was coming from church and I was on the road coming home and all of a sudden I heard a noise. Boom, 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 boom. I had fallen asleep on the highway and I heard that sound. Boom, boom, boom. And I woke up. I was driving down the side of the highway and I just turned onto the highway. Didn't have an accident because God's hand was up on me. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And I'm here today to be a witness of God's great power. Yes, sir. God can do anything. Yes, right. The song says, but fail.
Yeah. Come on. Hallelujah. Amen. I'm sure glad, brother. I wouldn't have nobody to play the organ or nothing if you got in a wreck. Amen. Amen. I love this brother, man. He's a good brother. He's pastored in Medill. How many years you pastored there? 26 years. How many vehicles you wore out going back and forth? Five or six. Yeah, he's wore out 5 or 6 vehicles. He drives them till they get like 350,000 miles on them, you know, and then he has to get another one. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Well, I guess it's my turn now. Amen.
And I love Jesus, and I appreciate where he took me. I don't know how much of my testimony y'all heard before, but, man, I was raised in a Christian home, and my mom and dad raised me pretty good. We went to the Baptist church and everything, but something inside of me, I had a restless spirit. I don't know what it is, you know, and when I got up in my teenage years, I kind of started turning into a troubled child, you know. I don't know. It was the devil working in my life. See, the devil can tell if you have the call of God on your life. You may not even know it when you're young. Maybe the people around you don't know it. But the devil can spot you if you have the call of God on your life. If you're going to be saved and God wants to use you, there's something in the spirit realm that makes the devil know that, and he attacks you more than he does regular people. And I believe that that's the reason that some of us go through so many heartaches and have so much rotten stuff happen to us, because the devil's trying to take us out early. He don't want us to grow up. Look at what happened to Jesus. Man, the devil had the king come and try to kill him, you know. And all he had to do is follow the star. You know, the shepherds followed the star. The wise men followed the star. But I believe the Lord showed me that the bad guys couldn't see the star. It's my opinion. I think the star was in the spirit realm. And I think only the people could see it were the ones that God opened their eyes and they could see that star and follow it and find out where Jesus was. If that wasn't true, then the king guys would have followed that star and found Jesus. But they never did follow him. Amen. And so you got to look at it like that. And we've got testimonies in here. A lot of us come from bad situations. We've been in prison. His mom deserted him, dropped him off someone and never come back. I mean, we've got people that come from all different kind of things. But it looks to me like the worst situation you come from is a greater opportunity for God to use you. You see, if God uses somebody that's a goody-goody, that was born with money and that has a high education and everything's going for them, it don't even give God glory. Everybody says, well, I expected that from them. They went to Harvard or Yale and they got money and stuff, and you expect them. But when he takes us, see, the Bible says he uses the foolish things to confound the wise. Well, man, that's me. That's me. See? And so you don't have to feel like, that's what I love being in the kingdom of God, Brother Gerald. The ground is level at the foot of the cross. Man, God is no respecter of persons, is what the King James says. That's a fancy way of saying God don't play no favorites. He doesn't have favoritism. God loves, Jesus loves all his children at exactly the same. Anything you see another child of God have, you can have it. Any anointing you see a minister have, you can have that anointing. Any knowledge you see somebody's gotten from heaven, you can have it. See, because all that heaven has to offer is ours as children of God. Amen? Amen? Man, I'm glad about that. And so we moved up here. In 1972, we moved here to Sherman. We came from Dallas. That was back during a turbulent time in Dallas. They started integrating the school system, and they were shipping the black folks over to the white church and the white people over to the black church. And everybody just wanted everybody to quit messing with them. We were perfectly happy, but they got to get in there and meddle with everything. And so it became a turmoil down there. So my dad says, well, I guess we're going to have to leave. So he moved up here. I'm the oldest of four kids. I've got a brother and two sisters, so we moved up here. So I had to go to my senior year. I graduated Sherman High School in 1973. I went to my senior year up here, and you know, you don't realize it, but things that happen to you affect you and affect your kids and stuff, and that affected me, Brother Bowen. I grew up in Dallas. I had all my friends there, you know, and I knew, I felt like that was home, and I was uprooted from home, and I was placed in a strange atmosphere with strange people. They were country people. I was from Dallas. I was a city person, you know, and I come up here and these are country people, and we didn't exactly jive. It seemed weird up here to me. And so And so the devil took advantage of that, and I started hanging around the wrong element. See, people are cruel, and I believe the devil has a satanic way to make you get rejected and make people pick on you and everything. And so I had started hanging around the dopers and stuff and the hippies and people like that, because they didn't care how you looked. They didn't care if you were a little different. They didn't care if you were a little bit weird. They accepted you. See, and so we need to make sure we're not guilty of that. If somebody's a little different, we need to love them. We need to accept them. So it all wound up that a few years after I graduated high school, that I joined this motorcycle club that's around here in the area called the Banshee Motorcycle Club. I ended up joining it. I went out there to Grayson County College. I took the paint and body course out there, and there was a guy out there, Catfish, and he was a member of the club, and I got to know this guy. And one thing led to another. He invited me over to his house, and I'd go over there and hang out. And I thought, well, man, these guys are pretty cool. They just ride motorcycles and drink a little beer. And you know, I felt like I had a place to belong, you know. People out there are looking for a place to belong. You know, we need that. God has placed inside of our psyche, in the way the human being is made, we need to feel like we belong somewhere, that we have a people that's like us, that love us and accept us like we are. And these motorcycle guys, they gave me that feeling that somehow that was missing in my life, you know. And I look back now, and that's what the church, that's what we're supposed to be giving to people. We're supposed to be loving people. We're supposed to be accepting people. And Jesus said, you'll mold my disciples because of their love one for another. Did anybody read the article that come out in the paper about the tent revival? It had a picture of Brother Sims on there playing the tambourine, and that lady quoted some stuff I said, and one of the things I liked in there that she said, she quoted, you know, I talked to her for about an hour and a half, and she took pieces out, but she said, Brother Jeff, he specializes under the tent, that he likes people to come that most churches wouldn't receive. He likes the drug addicts, the alcoholics, the street people, and people like the down and out. He likes those people to come to the tent. Man, I was so glad she put that in there. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, but isn't it a sad fact that places that are supposed to represent God would turn anybody away, you know? And on a cold night in the winter, we got people living in cardboard boxes, and we got people that don't have warm clothes, and we got people are hungry during cold weather, and we got big fancy edifices, big fancy churches that are heated and cooled and everything, and they're just sitting there empty. Just sitting there empty while these people are living in cardboard boxes. Myself, I'd open that sucker up and say, y'all, come on in here. You can lay in here where it's warm. We'll get you something to eat. Praise God. We're not going to let you stay out in the cold. Amen. I believe that's a sin before Almighty God, that we need to love all people from all walks of life, no matter what it is. So as a young man, I got in this motorcycle club, and I enjoyed the camaraderie, if you know what I mean. I enjoyed the camaraderie, man. I enjoyed having a place where I felt like I belonged. And you had to apply for this club, and you had to, well, they called it prospecting, or you were an apprentice. You couldn't just join the club. You had to like try out for it. It's kind of like when you join a sorority or a fraternity at college, you're like a pledge or whatever, and you have to hang around for a while before they think you're good enough to get in. And so I prospected for 10 months to get in this motorcycle club. They had me do everything. I had to wash motorcycles, fix flats, run errands, and do all kind of weird stuff, and I had to earn my way in. And when I finally got in, it would have been easier to go through basic training 3 or 4 times than all the stuff I had to go through. Praise God, I was a young guy. I'd have never made it. But when I was finally made it into the motorcycle club, Brother Bowen, and they gave me that patch, we call it our patch, or the insignia that you wear on your back, man, I thought I had something. I thought I was 10 foot tall, bulletproof, and invisible because I had made it and I'd received this patch in an outlaw motorcycle club. This place, I'm telling you, it was so tough that out of 10 people that would try to get in the club, maybe 2 people would make it. The other people would quit because it was too tough and they couldn't make it. And so, man, that got to be my lifestyle. Being in that dumb old motorcycle club was my lifestyle. And I see how there's certain parallels into our Christian lifestyle, and certain parallels is that see, if we're a child of God and our commander, our president, Jesus, if he paid the often price and he was tortured and he bled and he went through all the disgrace for us, then we need to wear our cut off. We need to wear our patch. We need to be proud of being a Christian. We need to walk around and being proud that our colors, that our club we're in, if you want to take it like that, that our commander is the king of the universe. You know what I mean? I look at it like before, I was a member of this punny little motorcycle club, but now I serve the king of the universe. Amen. And if I was proud of that motorcycle club, I ought to be 100 times more proud of what Jesus has done for me. And in the club, man, I wanted to be a good member of the club, Brother Boy. Man, I'd show up for meeting every Friday night. It was one of the rules. You had to show up for meeting every Friday night on your motorcycle. It didn't matter if it was raining. It didn't matter if it was snowing. It didn't matter if there was ice on the road. It didn't matter. You had to show up on your motorcycle. And I'd ride over there. Sometimes I'd suffer. It'd be so cold, but I would do it because I was proud of the club I was in, and I didn't want anybody there to think I was a wimp and I couldn't do what it says. Well, we need to get a dose of that in our Christian walk with Jesus. We need to get a dose of that. We need to show the devil that we're not a wimp. We need to show the devil that, bless God, we're going to serve Jesus. It don't matter if it's rain or shine. It doesn't matter if we have money or we're broke. It don't matter if we feel good or we don't feel good. It doesn't matter if our family likes us or our family don't like us. It don't matter what it costs us. We need to serve Jesus with the same vigor and the same proudness that these people in the other clubs do, man. We need to be the same way for Jesus. So, man, I'd ride my scooter over there. I'd wear my cutoff. Bless God, I was a Banshee motorcycle dude. And, man, I was proud of it, man. I thought, man, I said, man, I'm one of the chosen few, tough enough to make it in here, you know. And I got acquainted with all the other guys in there. And you know what I found out? That was back in the late 70s and early 80s. I found out that most of the guys in the club, I'd say 90% of them, had come out of the military, Brother Lauren. They were Vietnam guys. They were Marine Corps guys. They were Special Forces. They were Rangers. I mean, these are the elite of the elite, you know. These are guys that would sneak back behind the enemy lines and assassinate somebody, you know, for the government and stuff. And so what happened was that affected them. See, you can't do that stuff. It affects you, man. You can't kill people without it affects you. And what happened was they got out, and the trauma from all this and everything, that they had problems and they didn't fit in with society anymore. The church again failed them. Nobody loved them. Nobody ministered to them or anything. And the army or government failed them and just brought them home and dumped them out. They didn't have any kind of psychological help or anything, or any counseling or anything. Brought them home from the war and just dumped them out, Brother Bowen. And they're messed up and they don't fit in, and people kind of give them the cold shoulder because they're different and everything. And so what happened was they all kind of migrated and went into this motorcycle club because they're the only ones that would love them, accept them, and treat them like human beings, see? And you know what? The church, we don't need to let that happen, people. Every day we've got people getting out of jails. We've got people with problems. We've got people that's a little bit different than other folks. We need to love them and suck them into the kingdom of God, and we need to make them feel like they belong, and they won't have to go off in these weird clubs. They won't have to go off in these weird gangs or anything, because they'll be into the kingdom of God, and we'll love them, and they'll belong, and they'll be proud of what they got. We need to do that. You know, and it aggravates me because in some ways, even though they were heathens, the church could learn some lessons from them. And we had rules, man. I remember one of the rules was if you wore your cutoff deal you wear when you ride your motorcycle, it was against the rules to sit in a car or a truck with that cutoff on. And man, if you forgot and you were around one of the other guys in the club and you forgot and somebody drove up and you climbed in and sat in the front seat with them and another guy saw you, man, he said, you're busted. You sit in the car with your cutoff on. It's a $50 fine. Man. It didn't take very many $50 fines. You learned. I got to where when a car drove up or I thought something might happen and I might forget, I'd take it off and hang it on my arm. I'd hang it on my arm because I could get in the car then and I wouldn't be in trouble. Wouldn't have to pay a $50 fine, see. But we would watch each other out. See, now in the Christian realm, we need to watch for our other brothers and sisters. And if we see them violating a law, a spiritual law, violating something that Jesus said, if we see them hanging around with the wrong person, if we see them at the Mexican restaurant drinking a cold beer, if we see them doing something that we know has a potential to ruin their life, we need to look out for our brother. We're supposed to be our brother's keeper. You don't just look the other way and talk about them behind their back. You go to that brother and you check and you say, brother, is everything all right? I saw you had a cold beer. The devil's not tempting you to start drinking all the time again, is he? And you check on your brother and you see how he's doing. We're supposed to love one another and watch out for one another and encourage one another. We're supposed to do that. The thing that happens is that we just, I don't know what it is. It's of the devil. You can just watch somebody. You know they're going to crash and burn, and nobody will go to them and say nothing. Well, I'll pray for that brother. I'll put him on the prayer list. Well, he don't need no prayer list. He needs you to get off your rear end and go over there and knock on his door and look him in the eye and say, I love you. I don't want the devil to cause you to have a problem. I want to know what do I need to do to help you. I'd have never gone to prison if somebody would have come over there and cast that devil out of me. Years later, my dad and mom, they ended up getting saved and filled with the Holy Ghost because they said, son, you were so bad after hanging with those motorcycle dudes and after all the drugs and stuff, man, you were bad. We didn't think you had a chance. And when we saw what Jesus and the Holy Ghost did for you, they come to me in prison one time and they said, son, me and your mom don't understand the Holy Ghost stuff. But if it can change you, we want it. And my mom and dad got filled with the Holy Ghost. And in later years, my dad casted a devil out of my brother-in-law one time. He used to work for my dad right there in the living room. He started acting fruity, and Dad said, "Come out of him," and he fell on the ground and flopped around. My dad cast a devil out of my brother-in-law right there. Years later, my dad come to me and he said, "Son, if I'd knowed what I know now, I'd got four or five spirit-filled brothers, and we'd come over there to your house while you're sitting there in a stupor, smoking that dope and snorting that stuff up your nose and everything. We'd have come over there, and we'd all come in there, and we'd have tackled you, and we'd have wrestled you to the ground." He said, "And we'd have prayed in tongues over you. We'd have cast that devil out of you. It didn't matter if it took 2 or 3 days. We'd have stayed there till we got the victory." There's people in this tent right now that you know, people out there that need the same treatment. There's people out there that we know they're on the road to crash and burn. You can see it. It don't have to be a rocket scientist. You know the devil's got them and they're headed down the wrong road. Well, I got news for you. You can pray all you want to, but they need somebody to intervene, praise God. Jesus didn't say you pray out a devil. Jesus said you got to cast that devil out, and somebody got to go over there and swallow your spiritual pride or whatever it is, and you need to go confront that person and tell them you're loved and show them some compassion and get that thing out of them. Amen. Sometimes, if they're really goofed up, sometimes you got to say, oh, no, the devil ain't going to get you. No, we ain't going to let this happen. And you're hanging around them sorry old demon-possessed people. No, this ain't going to work. You pack you some clothes, you're coming home, you're going to live with me. Ah, what do you mean? I don't want to go. Yeah, you're coming. You're coming with me, man. If you like it or not, you're coming. The devil ain't going to have you. You're too weak. The devil will send one of those guys over there with some dope. The devil will send somebody over there tonight with another 12-pack or a case of beer tonight. Oh, no, we ain't going to leave you here. You're not strong enough to stand up by yourself. You're going to come and stay with me, and I'm going to pray with you, and I'm going to love you every day, and you're going to fellowship with me and Jesus. And all the other brothers of the church are going to come over, and we're going to cook some hamburgers, and we're going to have fellowship, and you're going to see what it's like to hang around good people that really love you and not these other scumbags that are full of devils that's trying to kill you. Amen. That's what it needs. See, when you got lots of dope, they're your buddies. Yeah, when you got a beer full of refrigerator, oh yeah, you got lots of friends then. Yeah, right. You got a new bag of marijuana, some good stuff, some Columbo or Acapulco Gold or something. Oh yeah, man, guys you hadn't seen in 6 months just happened to stop by. Hey, I heard that you got some special stuff. You got some hash. Ooh, see, that's how the devil works, man. We need to be smart. We don't need the devil to be smarter than us. We've all been there. We ain't all been saved all our life. When we see a brother going down that line, we need to go in there and intervene and save these people. I love the prison ministry. If the Lord blesses me with money, I'm going to have me a mission. I'm going to have me a place where people that are getting out of prison and people the devil has built up can come stay there. Where we can get them turned around, introduce them to a whole other circle of friends, and get them filled with the glory of God and get their life changed. The thing that would hurt my feelings so much is, man, we used to under the tent. Man, a lot of times, the first time I was set up here, I put this tent up here in 1993, and we had quite a few crackheads come here and get set free and delivered. And what would break my heart is, Brother Bowen, we'd work for hours getting the devil out of these people, and then I'd say, "Well, where do you got to go?" Well, my mom and dad gonna kick me out. I done stole from everybody, so they don't want me around. And I'm living down here at this crack house down here. Or I'm living down here with these sorry people down here. And I'd say, "Well, man, man, you can't go back down there and stay with those people. Man, they ain't your people. You're in the kingdom of light now. You can't go down there. But they didn't have anywhere else to go unless they wanted to sleep under a bridge somewhere. And I didn't have anywhere for them to stay, you know. If it was a guy, I can invite him to come stay with me, but I can't even find some lady to come over to my place and stay. And it just broke my heart that there was no place. I didn't have any place for these people that had been set free to stay. You know, they needed training. They needed to be brought up in the Word of God so they could see who they were. They were just little babes in Christ, man. And we birth these little babes in Christ, you know. We birth them, and then we're bad parents, man. You know, in the natural, if you have a baby and just chunk that sucker out there and don't raise it up, man, they throw you in jail for that. But the church is guilty of that all the time, man. We get people saved, and a lot of times they ain't even received the Holy Ghost yet, and we just chunk them out there to the wolves, you know. We don't check up on them or nothing. We know they all their friends are full of the devil. They've been an alcoholic for years and stuff, and we don't check on them. We don't befriend them. We don't go pick them up and take them out to eat once in a while. Man, you got to love these people. Talk is cheap. Don't it say faith without works is dead? Man, I feel for them. I was a convict. And bless God, I got out. I went to my mom and dad's house. But how many know a lot of those folks, they don't have a mom and dad's house to go to. They don't have it. They done ripped off everybody and stole from them, stole their mom's sewing machine and sold it and everything else. I mean, their families even abandon them. And until they get out and you help them do good a while and they get a job and then their family gets to know the new them and everything, eventually the Lord will repair that. But until the Lord repairs that relationship, we have to step in the gap and we have to do what's required of us as Christians. In a second, you can. I tell you what, man, Brother Andrew was one of a kind, man. I don't know if y'all knew Brother Andrew. Brother Andrew, he'd pick up a hitchhiker and lead him to Jesus. Then he'd ask him, after he'd lead him to Jesus, he'd say, "Well, where are you going?" He said, "Well, I'm just going down here to stay with some of my friends in Dallas, and we're all going to sit around and smoke marijuana and have a good time." And Brother Andrew says, "Oh, no, you can't go down there and do that. You belong to Jesus now." And the guy said, well, "I don't have anywhere else to go." And Brother Andrew would say, "Well, you're going to come home with me." And Brother Andrew would take him home and put him up in his house there. And I'd go to Brother Andrew's house. I remember sitting at the round table there he had in his kitchen there. And that was back Big Mama was still alive. And then I'd look off in the living room, and there'd be some strange-looking dude with long hair in there. And I'd say, "Brother Andrew, who in the world you got in the living room?" He says, "Well, that's a brother. I just picked him up hitchhiking. I led him to Jesus, and Jesus is changing his life." And you know, I would watch what would happen, and it wouldn't be 2 or 3 weeks, Brother Bowen. Nobody would say anything to him. He'd go to the barber shop, and he'd get a haircut, and he'd start looking like a regular guy. And then the next thing I know, I'd go back a couple of weeks later, and he done been down to Goodwill, and he got him some new threads, and he looked pretty good again. And then I would talk to him some more. Then I'd go back in a couple of more weeks, and I noticed he's not cussing anymore, and he's starting to act like a normal human being. Amen. And I would watch him get transformed, and Brother Andrew would keep him there. Sometimes he'd keep him 6 months if necessary while the Holy Ghost was cleaning him up. Amen. Man, it was good to see that. See, if we catch the fish, and we make real darn good sure that they are really born again and give their life to Jesus, all you got to do is love them and stand back and watch the metamorphosis happen. Because I'm telling you, this born-again experience is supernatural. The church has failed on preaching how supernatural the born-again experience is. The power of Almighty God comes into you when you're born again. The glory of God comes into your spirit. It says, "If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things has become new." You just love them and watch Jesus change them. Amen. Amen. That's what I try to do under the tent, man, all throughout the years. I try to help people have an encounter with Jesus. You know, I know if you ever meet the Master, you'll never be the same again. This brother here was a hard cookie. He was a hard nut to crack, but how many know the Holy Ghost got a big hammer? He cracked him on the head, man. Bam! And got him, man. Reeled him in, man. It wasn't me. That was the Holy Ghost got him, man. And brother, you've turned into one heck of a good Holy Ghost brother, you know it? I like the work Jesus does, don't you? He does good work. Amen. Hallelujah. So we're talking about me being in that dumb motorcycle club. But, and another thing, I had phone numbers. At that time, there was about 250 brothers in our motorcycle club. I had every one of their phone numbers, and we'd go, we had big, we called them parties, but what we'd do, we'd all get together and fellowship. After 2 or 3 years, man, I knew all these guys. I knew their wives' name, how many kids they had, what kind of motorcycle they drove, whether they worked for a living or sold drugs for a living or whatever they did. I knew them. And we were a tight group. If something happened, and it would once in a while would happen. One time a guy that lived down in New Orleans, he got in trouble, and one of the other clubs down there threatened him and said they were going to kill him and everything, and he made a phone call, and I got a phone call in the middle of the night and said, Stumpy's in trouble. Get ready. We'll be by to pick you up in 30 minutes. Man, I got my stuff. I went and got my pistol and got my hunting rifle, made sure I had my scope went on it and everything, and in about 30 minutes, they come by with an unmarked van and pick me up, and I climbed in that van. There's about 12 of us other brothers, just about all of us from the North Texas chapter, and we headed down to New Orleans, and when we got there, brother, there was over 150 of us showed up in 24 hours, and I want to tell you, them guys that were picking on him, their mind changed all of a sudden. All of a sudden, they didn't mind him anymore. And they gave him carte blanche treatment because they knew he had something backing him up. And it's the same way with us. We've got Jesus backing us up. We've got angels backing us up. We got the Holy Ghost backing us up. And when we get like we're supposed to be, we ought to be able to do the same thing. I ought to be able to make a phone call. I ought to be able to call Brother Gerald. And Brother Gerald calls Brother Bowen, and Brother Bowen calls this brother here. And I ought to be the same way for us. If we have trouble, I ought to be able to make an emergency phone call. I ought to be able to have 50 Christian brothers over at my place in a short matter of time. We fail in that. We fail. We have to accept it. We fail. In that area, we suck, man. Man, I've had a flat before. I've had a flat, and I've gone through my phone that's probably got 50 or 60 Christian people in there, and there's only 2 or 3 of them that I know that are sold out enough that'll come and help me fix my flat. The other one's got excuses. Well, either I'm at work, or I'm doing this, or I don't have time, or then blah, 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 excuse. That out of all those brothers, there's 2 or 3 of them. Brother Bowen's helped me. I've helped him. Gerald's helped me. I've helped him. Man, it shouldn't be like that. Man, if a brother's hurting and really needs you, you got to go tell your boss, man, I got an emergency, and I'll be back in an hour or two, man, and you go save your brother. Don't you think God's big enough to keep your job for you? You know, what if it was on the other foot? What if you had trouble and you desperately needed help? You know what I mean? Man, we suck in that area, man. We really do. And I used to love that feeling. And everybody in the motorcycle world knew that the guys in my club were tight. And they all knew everywhere I went, I could be by myself. I could go into the most ferocious hellhole, honky tonk or dive or club. I could go in, there'd be banditos in there, scorpions in there, any other club in there, and I'd be the only banshee, and I could walk in there and hold my head high and walk in there, and I know they wouldn't jack with me. I was outnumbered 100 to 1, but they knew that I had my brothers behind me, that if I just made one phone call, they'd come down there and kick their butt in a New York minute, and they knew it too, and they wouldn't bother me a bit because they knew what I had standing behind me. You know, the devil's the same way. He may hound you. He may pick on you. He may make you feel like you're unnumbered and everybody thinks against you, but you need to hold your head high, and you need to walk proud because you know that you know that you know who's behind you. You've got the throne of God and everything that heaven has to offer backing you up. You don't have to play second fiddle for nobody. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but a power, love, and a sound mind. Shakadadamaha. I'm telling you, this thing is real. One time I was in prison, and my mom and dad hired this lawyer, and they were trying to fight my case a little bit and trying to see if they could get it reduced a little and everything. So they pulled me out of prison, and they sent me to the Dallas County Jail. Man, the Dallas County Jail is the closest thing to hell you'll ever see on this earth. I'm telling you, that place is so demonized. You can go down there to Dallas. The building has gargoyles, demons on the corners of the building down there. I mean, it's a demon-infested place. And so they looked at my jacket. I get transferred in. They looked at my jacket. They said, man, this guy here is a gang member. He's a member of that motorcycle club. And plus, he's been convicted of aggravated armed robbery. Man, so he's at the highest level. So we have to throw him in the cell, in the pod that's for the worst criminals, the murderers, the very worst people. Because of my classification, they threw me in there, man. And so the guard, and it's so bad, the guards are scared to go in there because it's so bad. And it's got two doors, and they open one door. You know how it is. They open one door, and you have to go in there with your stuff, and then they close that door, and then they push a button to open the inside door, and then you have to go on in there because the guards, they ain't going off in there. They ain't going in there. And if you get in trouble in there, if those guys decide they don't like you and they attack you, you can forget it. There ain't nobody coming to help you till they come to drag your body out, because there ain't no guards coming off in there. And so back then I was a younger guy. And boy, I'll never forget the oppression, man, the fear. And they opened that one gate, and I went in there and had a little old bag of stuff. And those guys were looking at me. I'm telling you, they were licking their chops, man. I was kind of a young dude, and they were going to take advantage of me. They were going to take all my stuff. I didn't have nothing. I had maybe a few pens and some paper to write on and maybe a couple of candy bars or something, you know, in prison, man. Man, if you have a couple of candy bars, that's like a gold nugget or something, I mean, you know. Or maybe I had two or three of those ramen noodle soups. Man, in prison, they'll kill you for a ramen soup, man. So they put me in there, and everybody in this pod, about 30, 40 guys, they all come walking up there, and they're holding on to the bars, looking at me, licking their chops. I could feel the devils, man. They're looking at me. It's like, and then in the back, I really heard this. I heard this, Brother Bowen, with my natural ears. I don't know for sure. I don't know if it was natural or spiritual. I don't know. But I heard it plain as day. I heard it, and all these people they're waiting for the guards fixing to punch that button, and that inner door is going to open, and I have to go in there with these people. I felt like Daniel walking in the lion's den or something, you know. And I heard with my ears, they go, we've been waiting for you. That's exactly what they said, just like that. We've been waiting for you. Man, it sent chills up and down my spine, man. And I said, oh, man, I got to do something to change the situation here. And luckily, I'd been saved long enough. I knew that I had to bring Jesus. I had to bring Holy Ghost on the scene. And I knew that the Holy Ghost is there to confirm the word with signs following. I knew the name of Jesus is above every name, that every knee must bow of things or beings in heaven, earth, or under the earth. So right there, right before the officer pushed that button, I had me a Holy Ghost fit. I jumped up and down. I said, praise God and hallelujah to Jesus. I'm saved. I'm filled with the Holy Ghost. I prayed in tongues as hard and loud and fast as I could. I said, I serve Jesus and I belong to Him. And about that time, bang, he hit the button. I opened the door and I made myself, the Holy Ghost come on me. I walked in there like I was Al Capone or somebody. I walked off in there. I want you to know, all them guys that were ready to jump me, they just like somebody poked them and all the air come out of them. They just all kind of slumped and relaxed and just sleezed off over to what they were doing, you know. They just all left, and only three or four guys come up and meet me, and they came up and they shook my hand and they said, hi, I'm George, I'm saved too. And the other guy shook my hand. He said, hi, my name's Tom, I'm saved too. I'd like to be filled with the Holy Ghost like you are. And I had four brothers in there that were saved, but they weren't filled with the Holy Ghost yet. And before I left there, they were filled with the Holy Ghost, praise God. And I had those guys, they would come to me. They had pride, but they would come to me at night and stuff, and they'd say, will you please pray for me? I had a guy that had a migraine headache, and he came to me. He says, I've been fighting this migraine headache for 3 days. He had tears running down his face. He said, I ain't saved, I'm backslid. But he said, I know the power of God's real. I done seen it when I grew up and everything, and I've asked Jesus to forgive me, and this headache is gonna kill me. I can't take it anymore. Would you please pray for my headache? And I want you to know, right in front of those other inmates in there, everybody watching, I just laid my hand on that brother. I said, brother, Jesus loves you, and in the name of Jesus, be healed of this migraine headache in Jesus' name. And for the first time in my life, I felt this power, Brother Bowen. This power came on me, and I could feel it flowing out of me into this guy. And then it kind of freaked me out. I said, whoa. I said, oh, brother, Jesus loves you. And this guy, he just went, oh, thank you, Jesus, man. And then here in a minute, bam, the power hit him. He fell out on the floor right in front of all these heathens, man. Man, they were scared. They all backed away. Oh. It wasn't a minute or two. That guy got up. His headache was gone. He was a happy camper, let me tell you. He didn't care what they thought. It's gone. It's gone. Oh, my headache's gone. Oh, thank you, God, for forgiving me. My headache's gone. Oh, man, he was happy, I'm telling you. Those guys were backing off. What'd you do to that guy? That's what they told me. What'd you do to him? I said, I didn't do nothing. That's Jesus. See? And I had a great opportunity. I said, man, the power of God's real. All you guys in here need to get saved. The reason you're in here is you're all demon-possessed. You can't control yourself. You're completely out of control. Your life's out of control. When you get out right now, you go right back to the booze. You go right back to the dope. You all need Jesus, and He has the power to get rid of those devils in you. See, and that opened up an opportunity for me to preach to them. I'm telling you, this thing is real. I love having Holy Ghost adventures. Oh, give me a Holy Ghost adventure any day. Another time I was transferred to Paris, Texas. That's where I first got busted. I was transferred to Paris, Texas. And they put me in a cell there. And I'll never forget, the jailer's name was Neil. And this guy, Neil, he was a Christian. And I witnessed to him a little bit. And they put me in a cell there. And across from me, they had the drunk tank. And in this drunk tank, they had this guy. They said, man, Neil said, we got a guy in the drunk tank that he's out of his mind. They said, every day the paramedics come and give him a shot. But it only knocks him out for a couple of hours. And they said, man, he's ripped the stainless steel table plumb out of the floor. He's ripped the commode off the wall. And he won't put any clothes on. All he does is walk around naked and curse and pee all over everything. And that's all he does. And everybody's scared of him. And he belongs to a very wealthy and influential family, or we'd already done something. And we keep hoping that those drugs, whatever he took, is going to wear off. But he done been over there for 2 weeks, and it ain't wore off yet. And he's out of his stinking mind, and we don't know what to do. And I said, man, I knew what was wrong with him. I said, why, he's got a devil in him, you know. And you know, when you tell people that, it's like, whoa. And so the time come, about a week, I was there about a week, and Neil come up there and says, Leak, we got the inspectors coming. The jail inspectors, they come once a month to make sure everything's like it's supposed to be, and we're not allowed by law. We can't keep somebody in the drunk tank over 72 hours, and that dude's been there 2 or 3 weeks. And so while the inspectors are here inspecting the jail, we're going to have to move this guy into your cell. I said, say what? That guy's crazy. He done tore everything up in there. And he runs around naked and pees on everything. Man, I don't want that guy in my cell. He says, I can't help it. We got to do it. He says, but what I'll do is, he says, well, I got people watching these inspectors, and when they're getting ready to come in, I'll call the paramedics, and I'll have them come up and wrestle him down, and they'll give him one of those big giant shots, and it'll knock him out for a couple of hours. And they said, and then by the time the jail inspectors get through looking around, he ought to still be knocked out, and we'll pick him up and put him back in there where he came from. And I said, oh, Neil, this don't sound good. This don't sound good at all. And so I got ready. I said, well, this dude's peeing on everything. I moved into the top bunk, man. I put everything up there, man. He wasn't going to get me. And so it happened just like they said. They come and they gave him a, I could hear over there where they were keeping this guy. They had to wrestle him down. I heard it. He was hollering and cussing, and I heard him poo, 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 poo. And finally they wrestled him down, gave him this big shot, and here in a minute they had him. They just grabbed him by the legs and dragged him down the hall and dragged him into my cell. And he was naked as a jaybird, and they just picked him up and threw him like cordwood up on that bunk, lower bunk there, and then left. And I said, oh, Jesus, what am I going to do now, man? I got this crazy naked dude in my room. Man, what am I going to do? I said, what if he wakes up? I mean, you know. But then I got to thinking. I said, you know what? I said, his body's knocked out, but that devil in him, it ain't knocked out. No, that devil's still alive and well. I said, this sounds to me like a perfect opportunity. I've been wanting to do deliverance on somebody. I was a newbie. I ain't cast out very many devils. I said, I've been wanting to have a Jesus adventure, and this looks like an opportunity, and I'm locked up. What else can I do? So I got up, and I started back walking back and forth while he was laid there knocked out. I said, in the name of Jesus, whatever you crazy devil that's making this guy run around naked and pee all over everything, in the name of Jesus, come out of him. Come out of him, I said. You perverse sex devil. You naked devil. You devil that made him lose his mind. You drug devil. If whatever came to me, I'd say, come out. And then I'd pray in tongues a while. Shakalabaha. Nidumahondalabaha. Nikorasatalabaha. And I'd do it again. Yeah, you heard me, devils. Come out of him. You old naked weird devils. Come out. Come out, I said. Man, I did that for like, oh, I don't know. I did it for like 30 or 45 minutes. And I'd get tired. I'd just sit down over there a minute. And then I'd get up and do it some more. After about 45 minutes, all of a sudden he began to move. I got scared. I went and jumped up on the table in the corner of the room there. Man, I was scared. Man, it took every bit of strength he had. He was so doped up from that stuff. They told me later, they said a normal person would sleep for at least a week from the stuff they gave him, man. man, he just barely, he turned his head around and tried to raise himself up and couldn't hardly do it. And he could barely open his eyes. And he turned around and looked at me, and he looked and he went, and growled. And then the dope took over again, and then poof, he fell out again. And the Holy Ghost had to be helping me, because instead of scaring me, it spurred me on. I said, "Whoa, I must be hitting a nerve or something. It's doing some good." So I kept it up. I got up. I said, "Yeah, you know you have to obey. In the name of Jesus, Jesus said they will cast out devils. I have power and authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Come out of him." So I don't go more. Well, I did that for about, I don't know, another hour or two. And by that time, it had been about 3 hours, and that's about all that stuff would knock him out. And so he began stirring again. And so I jumped up on that table with my back to the wall. I said, "Well, man, if he comes at me, I'll kick him in the head or something, you know." Well, man, the guy woke up. He woke up, and he was still kind of dopey, and he real slowly sat on the end of the bed there, and I watched him. I was watching him closely, and he looked around, he looked down and stuff, and he realized he was buck naked. And then he looked around like this, and over here on the floor was his britches. And so he reached over here with his leg and got those britches and scooted them over to him. And he bent over and put his pants on. I was greatly encouraged, let me tell you. I was greatly encouraged. Then he sat there a while. He's a little stupefied. Then he sat there for a little while, and he got up, and he went over and used the bathroom instead of peeing all over the floor. I was more encouraged. And he come back and sit on the bed. And I said, "Man, this is a much improvement, man." I said, "I believe Jesus set this guy free." So there in a minute, he's still kind of in a stupor. I'm sitting over here on the table. And finally, he raises his head up and looks around and everything, sees me sitting there. And he looked at me, he says, "You've been praying, hadn't you?" That's what he said, just like that. He says, "You've been praying, hadn't you?" Man, he opened the door then. I said, "Been praying?" I said, "Do you realize what you've been doing?" And he didn't even know what he'd been doing. He says, "I don't know what you're talking about." And I said, "Well, let me tell you." I said, "You've been out of your stinking mind. You had a drug overdose, and the devil took you over. He took you over, and you've been over here. You've been running around naked for 3 weeks. You've been cursing everybody. Everybody's scared of you. You've been insane for 3 weeks." You know, and that was soaking in time. And I told him, I said, "Man, if you don't right now give your life to Jesus, right this minute, I said, the devil will come back and your mind could snap and you'll be insane the rest of your life. I said, you need to receive Jesus right now." And I gave him a little of my testimony. And, man, tears started coming down his face, man. The guy started crying. And I led him to Jesus right there. It was such a dramatic change that the word spread throughout the whole place. The sheriff came up there. And he would been so wild, and stuff, he would spit on him and do everything, that the sheriff came up there and he stood about 15 feet away from the cell and said, "Hey, Margraves, is that you?" And he said, "Yeah, that's me." And he'd get up and walk up to the bars, you know, and hang on the bars. "Yeah, that's me." And the sheriff would peek around the corner. "Well, are you all right?" "Yeah. Jesus saved me, and this guy casted the devil out of me." And so the sheriff would come out from around the corner and walk up there and look at him and say, Man, Margraves, man, you look a lot better, boy. Do you realize how crazy you were? He said, yeah, this guy and the trustees been telling me, they said I was running around naked and stuff. He said, were you? He says, man, when we arrested you, he said, with your fist, you smashed the windshield out of the cop car. He says, you were uncontrollable. He says, I'm sorry I did that, Sheriff. I didn't know what I was doing. Man, everybody came to see him, all the police, the highway patrol, everybody come and seen him. He told them how Jesus had set him free. Praise God. And he asked, he said, I want to read your Bible. And I said, well, I didn't know, man. He looked like a bum. I mean, he hadn't had a shower or nothing. And he looked like a bum. But I said, okay. And I handed him my Bible. He turned to the Old Testament and started reading the Old Testament. And that guy read the Bible like a scholar. He could pronounce all those hard words in there and everything. It freaked me out. And so I heard him reading that. I said, man, I knew he wasn't just some bum off the street. I said, man, who are you? He says, my name's Steve Margraves. He said, my mom and dad own the chain of pharmacies here in town, and they're very wealthy and influential. And he says, I was about ready to get my master's degree, and me and my buddy start partying. And he says, I still work part-time for mom and dad. And he says, I was stealing the drugs out of their pharmacy, and I was taking them back to college, and we were partying with them and everything. And he says, he finally ended up, he says, me and my buddies got hooked on that stuff. And he said, so I was doing it every day, and then I dropped out of college, and he said I was living in a homeless shelter over here, and mom and dad didn't know what to do to help me. And he says, then he says, I don't remember all this crazy stuff I did, but now I'm here. But that's what happened to me. That's what happened to the dude, man. His parents were wealthy, and still the devil got him, man. The devil got him. So his mom and dad, they pulled strings, Brother Bowen. They pulled strings. They prayed to have the cop car fixed. They made a donation to the jail. You know how rich people do. And they made it possible. All he got out of all that, he had to go to Rusk for a 90-day treatment and to dry out. That's all he had to do. And so last time I saw him, the deputy come to pick him up. He had his Bible under his hand. He was walking out. He was walking out to go to his treatment, and everybody in there said, bye, Margraves. Everybody came to the bars and looked out, bye, Margraves, see you later. And I went up there, bye, Margraves. I said, don't forget, keep thanking Jesus. He said, I'll never forget. He's walking down the hall, I'll never forget what Jesus did for me. Thanks a lot. See y'all later. And he went out the door and went for his treatment. Amen. Woo! Man, I was pumped then. I was pumped. I said, give me another one. So in 2 or 3 days, Neil came up there and said, hey, Leek, I got a young man down here that's on a special watch because he's tried to commit suicide before. So we got him on a special tank down there with a camera in there, and he's on a special watch because he's suicidal. I said, do you think you can help that young man? I said, I don't think I can help him, Neil. I know I can help him. I'll get him saved and cast that suicide devil out of him. He said, okay, well, pack your stuff up. I'm going to transfer you here in a minute. They transferred me down to that cell. This kid was about 25 years old. He had been on drugs and stuff too, and he had some kind of suicide devil in there. It didn't take me 2 or 3 days. I became his friend, and I started telling him about Jesus, and he looked up to me because I was an older guy. I'd been down in prison, you know. I'd been in prison and stuff, and I was an older guy, so he kind of looked up to me a little bit. And so the Lord helped me, and I began preaching to him, and it wasn't 2 or 3 days, Brother Bowen, I had him born again. Then I told him, I said, you need to talk like this. You need to have that. He says, I do. I said, oh, yeah, you need to have that. So I showed him some scriptures. I prayed with him. It wasn't 2 or 3 days later. I had him speaking in tongues. Then I said, you need to be knocked out under the power of God. He says, I do. I said, oh, yeah, the Holy Ghost will burn everything out of you. It'll renew your mind. It'll heal everything that happened to you, all those drugs and everything. You need to be knocked out. And I talked to him so much, it got to where he wanted it. He kept saying, man, when am I going to get knocked out by the power of God? I said, is that what you want, son? He says, yeah, you're right. I do want, I want to be knocked out. I want more. I'm not satisfied. I want more. I said, all right, here's what we're going to do. I said, you get your bunk down. You get your mattress down from the top bunk, and you lay it down here. And we're going to walk around the room, and we're going to praise God, and we're going to speak in our new language. So we got there, and we started praising Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. This boy here wants to feel your power. He wants to have an experience with you, Jesus. We thank you for the power. We thank you for touching this young man. And we'd walk around and speak in tongues. And he'd do what I did and everything. And the jailer's all watching this on camera. I didn't even think about it later, man, but they're watching this. And we're walking around speaking in tongues. And then after about 20 minutes, man, the Spirit came in there, and I said, all right, get ready. Get ready. Stand there in front of your mattress and close your eyes and think about Jesus. And so he'd walk around there, and he'd stand in front of his mattress and close his eyes like this. And I just went over to him and said, Jesus, bless him, Jesus. I didn't even get to touch him. My hand just got close to him. Bam! The Holy Ghost hit him. He hit that mattress so hard, it sounded like when you have judo or karate and somebody's thrown on the mattress. The Holy Ghost slam dunked him. Whoom! He fell out on the ground. He laid there. He was out for like an hour and a half, man. I don't know what Jesus was doing to that guy, but he was out for an hour and a half, man. Man, Jesus set that guy free. It's getting late, man. I can tell you adventures all night long. I'll save some for later. This stuff gets me pumped. You know what the only difference is between me and you? I don't know if you had any adventures or not, but I just stepped out and did it. I ain't no different than you. I'm no better than y'all. I'm no more anointed than the rest of y'all. Y'all got the same Holy Ghost I do. You serve the same Jesus I do. The only difference is I'm not ashamed to step out and try to do something. I mean, they're already goofed up. What are you going to hurt them any? You know? I mean, if they got a devil in them, if you can't get it out, they ain't no worse. They already got a stupid devil in them. The least you can do is try to get it out and do the best you can. See, but you'll find if you'll step out and do the best you can, the Holy Ghost, the anointing will come on you, and Jesus will show you how to do it because he wants those folks free. If somebody's dying of cancer, go up there and cast that cancer devil out of them. What do you got to lose? They're dying. I mean, if nothing happens, they're still going to die. See, me and Gerald, man. Gerald, man, he's my buddy now. He likes having adventures. We prayed for that lady in the diabetic coma, and she got up the next day and sat on the side of her bed. She'd been laying there for what, a couple of weeks or something. We prayed for the lady that had the bad liver, and the Lord healed her. I tell you what, I went up and prayed for Carol Mannery. Anybody know Carol Mannery? She's a preacher over in Denison. She was laying there, and they had her on the machine. She was in a coma, and they said, oh, Carol's going to die. I said, no, she ain't going to die. I said, I told her nephew, I said, have everybody else leave the room. You can stay. So he invited everybody else to leave. How many know you can't do nothing full of a bunch of people that don't believe nothing? I asked them to leave. I wasn't ashamed. Man, she's dying, man. Man, I just went over to her. I said, in the name of Jesus, you spirit of death, go out of her. Amen. I didn't pray a big prayer. I just said, Jesus, the devil can't have her. And I told that spirit of death to come out, and I told him, I said, keep all them people out of there. You're her relative. You tell the nurse to have them restrict it to only super close members of the family only, because those people there, they're not right. They're all full of doubt and unbelief. Same thing happened. Next morning, she woke up and was sitting in bed. The time I got there that afternoon, she was sitting up eating. She lived another 6 or 8 months. Eventually, she did die, but she lived another 6 or 8 months. And I'm telling you, man, I wouldn't take anything for this walk with Jesus. I've had more exciting adventures with Jesus than I ever had with no dumb old motorcycle club. I'm telling you, this is real. This is what I was looking for all along. We have what people are looking for. All these people you see out there with pink hair, big old giant holes in their earlobes, and their britches hanging down, their underwear showing and stuff, they're looking for something. They want something that's real. They want reality. They know that the status quo and the way everything is isn't satisfying. They have a dissatisfaction in their heart, and they're reaching out. When you see those people, that means on the inside, they're unhappy. They're desperate. They don't know what to do. Nobody's told them the truth. They don't know, man. Man, I walk up to them. I walk up to them and I said, man, that's the biggest set of ear pipes I ever seen. What size are them? Are those 3/4? I say, no, man, those are an inch. I said, well, man, dude, that's the best looking ear pipes I ever seen. I said, you got your tongue drilled too? No, nah, I don't have my tongue drilled. I said, well, all right, man. Then I whip out my card. My card's got my mugshot on it. And so I whip out my card and show him. I said, man, I was locked up for a while. Does that look like me 30 years ago? And I show him my mugshot. They go, wow, man, you were locked up, dude. I said, I sure was locked up. Wow, what happened, man? Well, I'm glad you asked. And I tell him, I said, I used to ride with the Banshee Motorcycle Club, man. I said, are people still smoking that Acapulco Gold and Columbo and stuff like they did in the old day? And he said, oh, no, man, now it's hydroponic, man. It's Sensimilia, man. I said, oh, man. I said, well, you know what? I said, after being in prison and everything, I said, man, I got something that's better than that. Oh, you do, man. You got something better. What is that? And I give them my testimony and tell them about Jesus, man. And they receive it good, man, because I'm not religious about it. I just tell them, I said, man, I said, I get high on the Holy Ghost. Man, I tell them about the power. I tell them some of my adventures I've had. And I've led quite a few of them to the Lord. Or at least planted a real good seed, you know, for them. So, man, I'm going to quit just because it's getting late. But I want to tell you, I love all y'all out there. And it's not an accident you're here tonight. You didn't really just choose to be here. You're here because the Holy Spirit overshadowed you and God placed in your heart a desire to be here. Where's everybody else? They're out watching TV. They're doing worldly pleasures and stuff out there. They could be here, but they don't hunger for God like you do. See, this shows that in your heart, you have a hunger for God. In your heart, you want more. You're not satisfied with what you have. You want to know Jesus on a deeper level, on a better level than you do right now. See, it's the fact that you're here. And so I want to tell all of you that you can be victorious. You can have adventures in Jesus. They may be a little different than mine, but every soul you save is important to God. It don't matter if we just get 2 or 3 people here under the tent. To Jesus, one person's soul is worth billions of dollars, everything. It's like they said, that Jesus would have done what he did. He'd have died for us if it was just for one person. He'd have done it. He'd have done it. And so, man, I tell you what, I'm glad I'm in a new club. I'm in the Jesus Club, man. And I'm proud of it. And I ain't gonna walk all beat down or nothing. I'm gonna hold my head high. I'm gonna wear my Jesus hat. Where's my Jesus hat? Man, I got a Jesus hat on purpose because I like to make the devil mad. Everybody else wears their hat. I ain't ashamed to wear no Jesus hat. I wear my Jesus hat everywhere. Everybody knows me 90% of the time, don't I, brother? I got my Jesus hat on, man, because I'm proud of my club. It's better than the Hell's Angels. Amen. It's better than the Bandidos or any of them other jokers. I got the real thing, man. If I can pray for you tonight, you come up here and I'll pray for you. If you hadn't received the Holy Ghost, I'll pray for you and we'll ask the Lord to fill you with the Holy Ghost. He'll be glad to do it. I mean, I'll help you any way I can. I'm, like I said, I'm really no different than any of y'all. I got the same Jesus. Anything I can do, you can do. It don't make any difference, you know. The only difference is I prayed for boldness. One of the first things, that's what you can pray for. You can pray for boldness because I'm telling you right now, if you'll get the boldness and you'll step out and start doing something, you're going to see results. You know, somebody challenged me one time. I said, well, I want to see people healed. And they challenged me. They said, well, start praying for sick people. And I prayed for about five people and nothing happened. And I called them back and I said, oh, I prayed for five people and nothing happened. They said, well, you get you a paper out. He says, you pray for 50. People. He says, you got to show the Lord you mean business. I mean, you're just playing around right now, but you get out there, you pray for 50 people, and then you call me back and you tell me what happened. So I kept a tally, and I started praying for people, and it wasn't until I prayed for maybe 20 people that I prayed for somebody, and man, the Holy Ghost came, and bam, they were healed. And I, whoa, praise God. And so I started praying for more people. I think it that first 50 people I prayed for, maybe like six or eight of them got healed. But as I was faithful to do what Jesus said that we're supposed to pray for sick people. It don't matter if they get well or not. That's Jesus' business. He's the healer. I'm not the healer. My job is just to walk down the road and smile and share Jesus with people. My job is just to share the love of Jesus with people. My job is just to lay hands on them in the name of Jesus. That's my job. And then go to the next one. I don't have to worry about it. Jesus is the healer. The results aren't my problem. My problem is just to do what he told me. I just lay hands on him and go right on down the road. He's the healer. And I found the more I do it, the more people I prayed for, my results started getting better after a while. See, you got to show God that you're willing to obey him. And as you do, your results will get better. Pretty soon it'll get to where a fourth of the people, you'll be getting 25% of the people healed. And if you're faithful, pretty soon you'll go along, and next thing you know, you'll look back, man, I believe about half the people I pray for are getting healed now. See, and your results will increase as you go on with Jesus. Your results will increase as you're obedient to him. So let's get out there and let's do the stuff. Let's do the stuff, man. Let's go find a bunch of weird-looking, tattooed-out, purple-haired people and get some of them saved. What do you say? Amen. Let's go find some church people that are just playing around. Let's get them saved. Amen. That's right. I mean, I'd almost rather preach to a purple-haired dude than some churchy person, you know. Well, my mom and dad went to this church, and my name is on the side of the pew where we paid and bought for one, and that's my seat, and I'm an elder in the church. Yeah, and you'll bust hell wide open, too. You need to get saved, you old religious thing, you. That's right. This ain't no country club. Hey. I don't care if your name's on the church book. I want to know if your name's in the Lamb's book of life. That's what I want to know. I don't care if you're influential with the church board. I want to know if you're filled with the Holy Ghost. That's the only influence I'm interested in. Well, if nobody wants prayer today, let's stand up then. I'm going to pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I speak blessings on everybody here. Every devil that's assigned to these people, loose them and come out of them. Every devil that's holding them back, come off of them. Every devil that's keeping them broke, come off. Every devil that's keeping them from not getting a job, come off of them. In the name of Jesus. Every devil of setback, depression, come off of them. In the name of Jesus. Now, Lord, I ask you to give them all boldness. Give them supernatural Holy Ghost boldness to go out and impact the world for Jesus. Touch them, Lord. Command all those spirits holding them back. Come out in Jesus' name. Loose them and come out of them. In Jesus' name right now. be free in the name of Jesus. Everybody say, I'm free in Jesus' name. Every spirit that's holding me back, say it. Say, every spirit that's holding me back, come out of me in Jesus' name. Say, I receive boldness in Jesus' name. Say, Holy Ghost, give me a fresh infilling. Jesus, teach me how to work for you. I want to be a good soldier. Thank you, Lord, for changing me. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Shakalaba netidibokombaladaha. Thank you, Lord. Amen. That's George Washington. I see him there. He comes to church a whole bunch. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Now, I prayed about it, and I've been thinking about it, and I've decided that tonight is going to be the last night of the revival tonight. It's going to be the last night. Now, we're going to do something else. I'm going to regroup. I'm going to ask Jesus what he wants me to do, and we're going to regroup, and we're going to do some more stuff. But for right now, we're going to quit this revival right now. Tomorrow, I've asked around. Most people, they go to their regular church. They got to get ready to go to work and stuff. I'm pooped, and I've got things I need to do desperately. My mom's 88 now, and I need to do some things with my mom and help take care of her and stuff. So for right now, brother, we're just going to stop right here right now, you know. But in the future, we're planning a fellowship. We're all going to get together and love one another. We're going to eat some hot dogs, and we're going to invite everybody to come. We're going to go into the highways and hedges. We're going to love those people. We're going to feed them. This brother here's got some connection up there in the area he live. We might do it several places, you know. We might target different places and have meetings where we sing and worship Jesus and love these people and witness to them a little bit and give them a hot dog and show them we love them, you know. Show them the love of Jesus. So make sure if you hadn't put your phone number or email address, put it on this list here, because when we decide what the way the Lord is going to lead us and what we're going to do, we'll call you and we'll tell you what's happening, so you don't have to be left out. But we're going to have some adventures, I'm here to tell you. And I want to say I love you all. Thank you for supporting me and helping me and encouraging me. I'm telling you, man, every preacher needs to have people to amen them and pay attention. I'd look out there, this brother here would be smiling, saying, go get him. And this brother here would be smiling, go get him. I look over here, Big Daddy, yeah. And I mean, it makes it easy to preach when you got people love you, supporting you and backing you up. And man, I love every one of y'all. And I tell you, y'all are an awesome group of people. And you all have callings on your life, man. I look out here, all y'all have callings and ministries the Lord wants you to be walking in. He does, all of you. And the devil's a liar. You got the call of God on your life, young man. Jesus is going to use you in a mighty way. That's the reason you've been through so much hell. The devil don't want you to figure out who you really are. Yeah, I'm talking to you, buddy. Yeah. Yeah, you're a strong man of God. Amen. Man, if he can use me, an old biker, and he can use an old hippie, and he can use Gerald, an old gangster, and he can use that brother there, an old alcoholic and a radiator man, man, he can use anybody. So don't fall for that lie of the devil. And he can use a UPS driver right here. Amen. I'm telling you what, that's the kind of people Jesus uses, is regular folks like us. Amen. So, man, y'all are dismissed. I love you so much. We got a little offering bucket up here. And I can't stand people that beg for money, so I ain't going to beg. I'm going to put it right here. And if the Lord leads you to put something in there, that's fine. I ain't worried about it. And I love you all very much. You're dismissed. Be blessed. Go with God. And Brother Bourne's going to play us a number as we are dismissed. And thank you. And that's it.